Good morning. Australia's coronavirus death toll has reached 74 after New South Wales recorded three more deaths. One of those at an aged care home in Sydney's west, which has now admitted it's struggling to find enough nurses to keep doing their rounds. Ellie Walsh is there for us. Ellie, good morning. Anglicare has effectively put out an SOS begging for help.
Yeah, they have, Davina, and that's because effectively Newmarch, the aged care facility, has lost around 40 or so members of staff, effectively because they've been put into quarantine or coronavirus isolation lockdown. This follows the news that a third elderly resident here at the aged care home has passed away. The aged care home here in Kingswood, which is in Sydney's west, she was aged 92. This, of course, follows the news of two men had passed away, 93-year-old and a 94-year-old, also dying of coronavirus here at the facility. Now, Anglicare say they're working around the clock to try and halt the disease, but their resources are incredibly stretched during this time. In a statement to Nine News, the CEO said, "We are in the eye of the storm. Everyone is struggling to find staff for us, including the Commonwealth Government and eight agencies. On some days, we struggle to have a full staff complement, and it's no one's fault." So, families of those in care here are incredibly distressed. Some have tried to take family members out of care before the lockdown. Others are calling for tighter restrictions. Here's Dr. Kerry Chant's response to that.
So some of the challenges are that if you test the aged care worker at the beginning of the shift, they may be positive at the end. So we cannot absolutely preclude that COVID-19 is not going to get into an aged care facility. What we can do is everything possible to minimise that. And that requires the actions by visitors to be thoughtful when they're visiting aged care facilities to ensure that they're symptom-free, to ensure good hygiene. We've also suggested that children and younger people that can't comply with those social distancing measures and hygiene do not attend. Similarly, the staff screening and having those symptom checks and temperature checks, if appropriate, are another barrier, but we all have to work together at keeping our aged care residents safe.
Now, Davina, it's a pretty quiet morning down here at Newmarch, and that's because families are not able to visit the residents inside this facility. So apart from about three security guards who continue to come down here for the facility and check up on us, nothing much going on. That will all change, though, this afternoon, a planned protest at 4 o'clock today.
Okay, Ellie, we'll leave it there. Thank you. Let's go to breaking news unfolding in Canberra right now. Our political reporter Jonathan Kersley has the story. Jono, what can you tell us?
Davina, the Prime Minister spoke with US President Donald Trump this morning. They discussed their respective responses to the coronavirus. Nine News understands that the President noted Australia was doing well in regards to the handling of the coronavirus here. Just 70, a touch over 70 deaths as opposed to the tens of thousands we've seen in the US. The pair also spoke about wanting to get their economies moving again. We know the President in particular has been wanting to reopen and ramp up as much of the US as he can, a lot faster than many other countries have been able to. The Prime Minister has warned of 6 months of restrictions here, but said yesterday we are now on the road out. The leaders, I'm told, also spoke about transparency. You'd think that would be around China's response to the virus, which started there. Australia wants an independent inquiry to examine the causes of the spread, how it managed to get around the world so quickly, and has questioned how truthful China has been. For that, the Chinese government has delivered Australia a very stern rebuke. President Trump has been scathing of the Chinese administration in recent days, largely seen in the US as a distraction from his own handling of the crisis there. The leaders also spoke about wanting to improve the World Health Organization, which the Australian government and President Trump have both been critical of.
Okay, Jono, the government's also claiming some good news on fuel supplies for the future.
Yeah, Davina, Nine News understands the federal government very close to an announcement. It says will boost fuel security in the country. It will sign a deal with the United States to buy fuel and store it in America's fuel reserves, which they have had since the 1970s. Australia actually has very little storage here at all. It's been a long-running problem. Consistently, we have not met international targets for stockpiles of oil, which is 90 days. And for a long time, we've been very well below that. Analysts say what the government is doing now is looking to capitalise and buy oil while it's incredibly cheap. We're seeing seeing that at petrol bowsers across the country as the price plunges below $1 a litre in some cities. But there are questions over how much more secure this makes our fuel supply, given it would still be based all in the US. Nine News understands there are discussions underway about developing fuel storage facility here in Australia after the coronavirus crisis ends.
Jonathan Kersley, live in Canberra. Thank you. OK, we're going to take you to Sydney now, where former NRL CEO Todd Greenberg is speaking. Take a listen.
In NRLW, I hope to see that prosper in the years to come. You know, sitting at the 2017 Grand Final and watching Macklemore perform, and I suppose seeing the inclusiveness of the sport portrayed was fantastic. And in more recent times, I think the work the game's done on concussion and protocols around players has been world class. So there's a lot of things I'm proud of. It's been a wild ride, and I've enjoyed every bit of it.
Comes with criticism.
Yeah.
Scapegoat for some of this drama recently?
Look, people will make those decisions themselves. My personal view is that in a role like this, you always take criticism. That's the role. I've said this on a number of occasions to you and others. It's not a popularity contest. I understand that. But it's been a hell of a journey. We've loved it. My family and I, we've made lifelong friendships. My wife and I have travelled the world. We've seen and met people we never thought we'd meet. The number of messages I've received in the last 48 hours has been just mind-blowing. And it's been a great journey, but ultimately, sport's a tough industry. Rugby league's no different. I've said it before. It's brutal on the field and more brutal off it. But that's okay. I've had a great ride.
Just off the back of the criticism, is there anything you would have done differently, do you think?
No, not at all. I mean, you can't look through the prism of hindsight. You do what you think is best at the time. Everyone's human. You're going to make mistakes occasionally, but one thing I think people know about me is I was always up front, I was always direct, I was always honest, I was always prepared to front the media in good and bad times. And there was a lot of difficult moments through my tenure, a lot of hard decisions. That's not to say we got them all right, but we were always up front about it. And I always did it with the game's best interest at heart. And that always comes with criticism, but that's okay, I'm a realist.
Where to from here, do you think?
Well, the four of us are going to enjoy each other's company. I may get under their feet a little more than normal, reintroduce myself to my family, and I think they'll start to see my sense of humour return a little bit as well, and really just sort of recharge and re-engage a bit, and then I'll see what's next. There's another chapter for me, but I'm going to have a good rest before I even think about that.
And you won't be turning your back on the NRL?
I love the game. I have absolutely loved the game since I was a little boy. I'll continue to be its greatest fan. As will my family, we'll watch all the games. We've loved it. As I said, it's been a fantastic journey. We've met great people, and I walk away being a great fan of rugby league, and that will always continue. Cool, guys. No worries, guys. Good on you.
Todd Greenberg speaking in Sydney after stepping down as NRL CEO. We know that Project Apollo is also meeting this morning, talking about the resumption of the NRL season for 2020, including how many rounds will take place, potentially when the grand final will take place, and the state of origin. So we will have those details for you if they break today, when they happen. Well, Victoria has recorded just two new infections, but with that good news comes a grim forecast of the state's economy. Carrie-Anne Greenbank has more.
Well, this morning the Victorian government painted a grim picture of where the state's economy is headed if social distancing restrictions remain in place for the next 6 months. They've released modelling done by the Department of Treasury and Finance, which indicates that 270,000 jobs will be lost in this state, essentially doubling the unemployment rate. The state's GDP is set to decline by an unprecedented 14%, and property prices expected to drop by 9% by the end of 2020.
These figures are bleak. They're quite frankly quite catastrophic. But let's not sugarcoat it. We are in for difficult times. There will be a return to better economic times, but it will take time. We will see probably the height of this economic event work its way through in the September quarter of this year. We won't, in my opinion, have a V-shaped recovery.
All this in the face of having only two new cases of COVID-19 in Victoria overnight. Our death toll remains stable at 15.
They are fragile. And if we relax restrictions too quickly and too broadly, then we will be back where we were 2 or 3 weeks ago, with the number of cases doubling every few days and even stricter lockdowns necessary.
The Premier reinforcing today, we're still weeks away from having some restrictions lifted.
For the second time in just 3 days, Queensland has recorded no new cases of COVID-19, with more than 90,000 coronavirus tests completed overall. It's particularly good news for far north Queensland after a cluster of cases recently emerged in Cairns. That region recorded zero positive tests overnight. The Sunshine State now has a total of 1,024 cases. Let's go to James Wilson, who's live for us at Port Kembla now, south of Sydney, where more crew members are waiting to depart the Ruby Princess. James, good morning to you. So who's coming off the ship today?
Good morning, Davina. Well, we thought yesterday's operation was big. Today, it is six times the size. Currently, 275 Filipino crew members are disembarking off the Ruby Princess. They'll then be placed into buses, which will head to hotels in Sydney and then eventually to Sydney Airport, where they will be repatriated back to Manila. I want to take you to some chopper pictures from this morning. You can see the operation is quite similar to the one we saw yesterday. Crew members come off one by one. They then head to a disinfected station before being sanitised. They grab their luggage and, as I said, then placed into eight different buses, which will be leaving here in a matter of moments. Now, we know that the group that left yesterday, 57 crew members, nine of them have already been flown back. 18 are expected to fly home today. It's extremely positive news after spending more than a month stuck on this ship, 2 weeks at sea and 2 weeks at Port Kembla. There is still, of course, a health crisis unfolding on board. We spoke with the police commissioner about that situation this morning. Take a listen.
There's around 40 crew members who are corona positive that health are monitoring closely, and will continue to work with health between now and Thursday to bring any crew members off the ship who require urgent medical treatment.
Well, Davina, despite this situation, police are giving every indication the ship will leave tomorrow. The captain has been given a clean bill of health. As for the remaining crew members on board, their chance to be repatriated is shrinking by the hour. Police said if they're not organised through Carnival Cruises or their consulate, well, it's too bad. They'll have to remain on the ship when it leaves tomorrow. Davina?
We'll see what happens in the next few hours. James, thank you. Well, there could be some hope for struggling airline Virgin Australia as newly appointed administrators search for a successful way forward. Here's Jess Millwood.
Well, Virgin says there are in excess of 10 parties interested in potentially saving the airline. Some of them are based overseas, some of them based in Australia. Aside from that, that's about all we know at the moment. The CEO, though, is adamant this isn't the end of the airline, rather a new beginning, and they will come out of this stronger and tougher. But a word he also used to describe the future is leaner. So we wait to see what this will mean for staff and for route reductions. For the moment, though, the CEO says there will be no further staff redundancies. The union is calling on the government to step in at the last minute to buy a stake in the airline, as saying if they don't, we risk it all going overseas. That is something the government hasn't ruled out. They've said for now it is up to the shareholders to work this out, and they will take a look at the airline once the administrators have done what they need to do. Here is the Deputy PM.
We need a solution out of this. We want two commercially viable airlines coming out of the back end of COVID-19. There is now a clear flight path forward for Virgin, a future for Virgin. They've taken the courageous decision with Paul Scurra, with the board, to go down voluntary administration.
The Virgin Velocity points program is a separate entity, not in administration, so those points will be preserved. And the administrator is confident that any flight credits will be honoured. Of course, that will all be up to the new owner, and we could know exactly who that is within 12 weeks.
There is confusion this morning among South Australian families over whether or not students should return to the classroom when schools reopen next week. Authorities are adamant schools are safe, but the Education Union has launched a Keep Them at Home campaign. In Victoria, learning will remain online for the whole of Term 2. Stay safe and honour our veterans at home. That's the message for Australians ahead of Anzac Day. With the cancellation of all official services and marches, we're being urged to watch a special live stream broadcast from the Australian War Memorial on Saturday morning.
Unfortunately, this year, all of us have to do things differently. We can't turn up to the dawn service, we can't turn up to marches, we can't turn up to those regular things we do. But what we can do is still honour our servicemen and women, past and present. We can still acknowledge those in our family who've served and, of course, support the RSL in their efforts in making sure everybody appreciates the significance of Anzac Day this year, although it will be done in different circumstances.
Residents in New South Wales are also being told to stay away from memorial parks throughout the day.